In this month's Seamaster Sailing, we're first onto the 2016 Olympic Sailing Racecourse as we head to Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, for the finale of the 2012 Extreme Sailing Series World Tour. From there, we travel on to Melbourne, where the Olympic journey towards Rio 2016 actually begins with the first round of the 2013 ISAF World Cup, and out into the oceans for an update on the four-yearly ocean classic, the Vendee Globe. 20 solo sailors started in front of millions on the quayside, but as the race reaches its final stages, there's still no clear and decisive leader. And finally to Malaysia for the Monsoon Cup Match Racing Regatta, and a look back at 2012 through ISAF Rolex World Sailor of the Year Awards from Dublin. Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, was a vibrant, exciting, and spectacular backdrop for the finale of the Extreme Sailing Series World Tour. The racing took place on the waters where Olympic medals will be decided in 4 years' time. After six rounds, there were still four teams with a chance of winning. On top was Lee McMillan and his team, the Wave Muscat.
We're winning the overall series here in 2012. It's the last event here in Rio, and we're just hoping really to finish off the good work that we put in all year. And the pressure's still on. It's been tight all year, so we haven't got a huge lead. We're very keen just to sail well, and hopefully we can win this year.
The Wave's teammates, Oman Air, made an impression on the circuit in their first year and arrived in Rio second overall behind the Wave.
We're keen to end it on a high note, and I really believe that we put all our hard work in. It's time we win one.
Group Edmond de Rothschild from France were pre-season favourites, but with a disappointing start to the year, a win at the penultimate event in Nice, France, gave them a shot at the podium.
Nice was a good event for us. We were really not looking good before Nice, but we knew it was up to us to react and say, OK, either we sink or we can raise our head and be in good form in Rio and fight for the podium.
And the final team in contention for the podium were Red Bull Sailing Team, where four Olympic gold medals among the team speak of a pedigree with winning experience. On day one, it was Alinghi from Switzerland who hooked into the Rio racing conditions to end the day at the top of the leaderboard.
Yeah, we had a great day, actually. We changed the crew. We have a new helmsman and a new tactician. So the goal of the day was to keep it simple as possible. We had a good start, good boat speed. Yeah, we are very happy tonight.
But by day three, Red Bull, the Wave Muscat, Group Edmond de Rothschild and Oman Air were at the top and separated by just 4 points. We join race 19, where the Wave Muscat had slipped to fourth overall, a position that would threaten their overall circuit victory chances.
Dark blue sails, Group Edmond de Rothschild lead, but look at the Wave Muscat, the two-tone blue in third place.
Beautifully close race now. The Wave Muscat squeezing in on the inside. I think they're going to overtake him on that gate mark.
And Lee McMillan has made a sublime move there and has just sailed straight past Group Edmond de Rothschild. And will round the bottom mark. The boats can go around either of these two marks. And Lee McMillan comes towards camera. But this is Lee McMillan, Wave Muscat, on course for the finish. Pressure behind. Okay, McMillan says, jibe now, standing up, familiar pose. Tiller extension behind him. Little tweak there on the Jenica by McMillan. Nice jibe, stays down a little bit, confident sailing. Rolls into another jibe, under real pressure from Group Edmond de Rothschild behind. McMillan now is under attack from the French team, heading towards the finish, 100 metres away. Cool as it likes. Beautiful, composed sailing. Lee McMillan on the Wave Muscat could have lost two places. He lost none. Victory for the Wave Muscat, second place for Group Edmond de Rothschild.
Race 19 was the defining race for the Wave Muscat. Jumping from the back of the fleet to first put them just behind Group Edmund de Rothschild and set up a tasty contest on the final day.
Last day of the year, so it's pretty exciting. It is just another day's racing, and we just want to sail well. And if we sail well, we know that we can come out and win the whole series. We want to push really hard for the victory here in Rio. That will kind of cement the overall victory as well.
But it wasn't an easy start for McMillan and his team.
Come on! No way!
The Wave went on to win race four of the day, drawing them level on points once again, with just the double points final race to sail.
We're looking at the Wave Muscat win this. They've won the title and they've won Rio as well. Line clear, that's the start. And the Wave Muscat are very, very late for the start. And ironically, there is no wind. There was a squall there blowing, 25 knots 30 seconds ago. The Wave Muscat are standing still and they're not past the line. And look at this, to add to the drama, Group Edmund de Rothschild is charging down behind them with a big gust. The light blue sails of the Wave Muscat just behind is Group Edmund de Rothschild. They don't want to play follow my leader. They're tacking, trying to find their own wind. And that looks like a good tack because they've hit breeze straight away. Group Edmund de Rothschild are rounding the top mark and head down towards the finish. It's a sprint to the finish for the French team. Can they win the medal race? The final race here, the decider.
Looking back at the fleet a little bit, Red Bull is doing well. At the moment, they'd be on the podium. They've got 2 points lead overall to Oman Air. Oman Air would have to catch up one more boat.
And Group Edmund de Rothschild win the final race. Well, that's all they could possibly do at the end, and a race that will never be forgotten on this tour. Celebrations on board, but it will be for second place in Rio because the provisional scores are telling us that the team that are about to cross the line, Lima Mellon and the Wave Muscat, win by 0.2 of a point. Provisional scores here. The Wave Muscat are the 2012 Extreme Sailing Series champions.
The Extreme Sailing Series 2012 World Tour officially came to an end with an impressive 1-2 overall finish for Oman, with Group Edmund de Rothschild rounding up the podium in third. The 2013 Tour is right around the corner. First stop, Oman. ISAF Sailing World Cup, Sail Melbourne, is where the stars of the 2016 Olympics begin their road to Rio. Sail Melbourne is the first international Olympic event after London 2012. There are new faces and new classes too. Australian 470 sailor Malcolm Page won his second gold medal at London 2012, but he's moving on.
Coming out of the back end of the London Olympics, I've retired from Olympic sailing after 15 years of doing that. So it's I feel like obligated in many ways, but also excited to be here as a patron of Sail Melbourne. It's obviously one of the World Cup events that's around the world. I think there's five of them now in this new Olympiad.
Page's former helm, Matthew Belcher, carries on the Olympic dream and has signed up a new young star, his former training partner, Will Ryan.
Absolutely love Sail Melbourne. It's sort of a bit of a tradition that every time we start a new partnership, we have to start at this event. It's always done us well in the past, so fourth time, fourth new crew for me, my fourth sort of cycle, and yeah, it's exciting, especially for Will and I. We haven't been in the boat that much, but it's just nice to be here and be part of it. It's a huge event.
Belcher and Ryan were challenged, along with all the other Olympic classes, by big waves, strong winds, and fickle breezes too. South African duo Jim Asinati and Roger Hudson were at the Australians' heels, but they couldn't match the Aussies' perfect score. One man who enjoyed the conditions was Australia's Brendan Casey, who won the Finn event. After finishing 13th at London 2012, it was a great way to start his year. Australian Crystal Weir finished 12th in 2012 in the laser radial, but in Melbourne finished with a massive 22-point lead.
Going in today, I had an 18-point buffer, which was, you know, nice to go into the race. And in that race, you know, I didn't really want to be risky at the start, so I held back on the start line and I paid the price around the first lap and rounded like fifth. And then on the second beat, I caught up to first. So it was good. It's a good race.
In the men's laser, Australia's Tom Burton is following in the footsteps of teammate and gold medalist Tom Slingsby. Burton finished with a 14-point lead over his nearest rival, Matthew Wynn from Australia. And the women's 470 event was won in style too by Australia's Sasha and Jamie Ryan.
Today it was pretty windy out there, definitely pretty challenging conditions for us. So we just wanted to sail conservative. We started well and then throughout the race managed to get back to the front.
And there were new classes in the Olympic competition for the first time. The men's 49er was joined by the new women's FX, bringing twin trapezing for men and women. Luke Parkinson and Jasper Warren from Australia came through to take gold in the 49er after a capsize in the medal race. In the women's FX, it was Australia's Alex Maloney and Molly Meach who took the historic first ever FX Olympic regatta win. Melbourne began the long road to Rio in 2016. The next steps will be taken in the USA at the Miami Olympic Classes Regatta in late January. The Vendee Globe is sailing's toughest solo challenge. It takes 3 months to sail 26,000 miles non-stop around the world on your own. And for this reason, it's one of the hardest goodbyes in sport. Hundreds of thousands poured into the race village to get a glimpse of the 20 skippers lining up for the 2011-2012 edition, which, as ever, starts and finishes in Les Sables d'Olonne, France. The competitors here are legends in offshore sailing. The Vendée is no round-the-world cruise.
Well, obviously, there's a big sense of excitement, anticipation for what is to come. But right now, we're kind of thinking about the start. But it's hard to not ignore the fantastic public who are here supporting the event. It's just amazing. It's something special.
Can't you do that?
After 4 years of preparation, every sailor was anxious to get going. So much so that three boats were over the start line early in a 26,000-mile race. But after a month at sea, seven of the 20 starters had been forced out of the race with technical problems, including the only female skipper in the race, Sam Davies, whose mast crashed down after only 5 days. The Vendée has been dominated by French skippers. Since the first edition in 1989, there has never been a non-French winner. And once again, France was at the head of the fleet from the start. François Gabart and Armel Lecléac were in sight of each other almost every day for more than 2 months. They traded the lead many times, until Gabart extended a lead of around 100 miles approaching the equator on the return north. As the leaders approached the equator, behind, Barcelona World Race winner Jean-Pierre Dick was being hunted down by a rising British star. Alex Thompson on Hugo Boss split from the fleet and headed close to the coast of Brazil. It brought him right back into contention for third place with a tasty final 5,000 miles in prospect. One man who suffered the more brutal side of the race is Bernard Stam. In two attempts, he's yet to finish. And his chances took a blow again when he was forced to divert to Enderby Island, south of New Zealand, to repair his hydro generators. In the process, he broke a fundamental race rule when a sailor from a Russian ship jumped onto his boat to help secure it to the side of the ship while Stam was below. The Swiss sailor was disqualified for receiving outside assistance. While many of the other skippers campaigned to have Stam reinstated, he restarted and set off for Cape Horn. But he hit an unidentified floating object, ripping off his only working hydro generator. Without power for his autopilots, water maker, and navigation systems, Stam struggled to continue and was eventually forced to retire just after Cape Horn. Next month on Seamaster Sailing, we'll catch up with the final third of the race and the compelling battle back into the Northern Hemisphere and onto the finish in Les Sables d'Olonne. The Alpari World Match Race Tour came to Palur Delung in Kuala Chengdanu, Malaysia, for the tour finale. For sailors, it's a tough event. The finale of the race, raced in the challenging Malaysian conditions, dominated by light winds. But with a prize purse of over €375,000, there was plenty of incentive. Plus, the Match Racing World Championship was still to be decided, with only three skippers in contention. The World Match Tour trophy has been engraved with many legends of the sport, including Ben Ainslie, Russell Coutts, and Ed Baird. Plus, match racing's grandmaster, Australian Peter Gilmore, the first person to win four consecutive titles, who announced his retirement from the series in Malaysia.
It's been a great career. I think it's time to step aside. And I'm delighted to be doing that at a time when the conclusion of the Monsoon Cup, I'll be stepping down from the Alpari World Match Racing Tour.
Bjorn Hansen currently led the tour into the final, but made a punchy call to take on three times world champion Ian Williams in the quarterfinals to decide the world title.
We're looking forward to this so much. I mean, we have a really good chance to become the world champions.
He rolls up and through. Obviously wanted that right-hand side. There's the gun, both boats clear. Hansen will be faster at start time. So here we go, it's showtime. Williams with a small dial. Coasts up. Crosses the bow of Bjorn Hansen.
Doesn't have to. Only
we're
going to
see
him
take
the
no prisoners here. He's coming up for the luff. We see Williams jump.
Okay. Okay, come on. Okay.
Hey, Williams has a much messier turn.
Kiwi.
It looks like he's going around the same mark as Ian. That is a turnout for the books. He gives Ian the inside line.
Just,
but
he's
so much faster.
See if he can get right round the outside of him.
Bjorn Hansen has to luff. The bows are absolutely even between these boats. Hansen will luff Williams here and try and force him through the tack. And there he goes. Williams is tacking off to that right-hand side. But it is Ian Williams of GAC Pindar who approaches the line. They punch the air as they turn down through the wind.
Come on!
High fives all round.
Williams won the world title by winning the quarterfinals and thereby toppling Hansen. But the newly crowned world champion then lost out to Robertson in the semi-finals for the Monsoon Trophy. While on the opposite side of the draw, Canfield beat the legendary Gilmore and now takes on Robertson in the final.
There we go, it's a yellow. A yellow-red penalty. It is just a wash of penalties out here. I have never seen a finish like this. In all my years of match racing, I think Robertson's going for another. Taylor Canfield's completing his. There's now only two flags up, and I think if Robertson can turn down and go through the wind, he will win this match. The penalties are now off, and they're heading back towards the line. It is going to be neck and neck between the two. But it is Taylor Canfield, ultimately, that wins that match. I have never seen a match like that.
After that penalty-ridden match, Canfield sailed a clean race for the Monsoon Cup win, his most impressive sailing achievement to date, which gives him a strong chance of being invited to be a tour card holder in 2013. In an Olympic year, it's only natural that athletes from London 2012 dominate the nominees in 2012's ISAF Rolex World Sailor of the Year Awards.
The male winner of the ISAF Rolex World Sailor of the Year, Ben Ainslie.
It was certainly one of the hottest lineups I've ever seen for a World Sailor of the Year award. So I was—I think I was as surprised as anybody when my name got called up.
The female winner of the ISAF Rolex World Sailor of the Year award is Lisa Liu.
It is the sport of sailing which gives me the chance to chase for my dreams, provides me the opportunity to see, feel, and explore the world. And sailing leads me to a path of a better life. Thank God for sailing. What a lifelong sport. Thank you, everyone.